Kelly does an excellent job also. Kay's kind of a professional volunteer, and she also does a wonderful job. So we've got lots of folks here that really, I know, care about the community. So welcome. I'm Vicki Cook, and tonight I'm just going to talk about Judiciary, but I'm going to start with first the courts that have the least subject matter jurisdiction and go all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And how I'm going to do that is by asking you guys some questions so it won't be too boring. Hayden asked me if I had a PowerPoint, and I said, are you kidding me? I have hard copies. My husband is very funny. He really poo-poos PowerPoints, but actually I think they're quite good, but I'm just not doing one because I don't know how. But anyway, so if you have a traffic ticket or a DWI, or if, say, your neighbor's dog has knocked down your fence and you have about $25,000, up to $25,000 damage, or in some cases $5,000 property damage, or you had somebody that was supposed to come tile your kitchen and they never showed up and you want some damages, civil damages, somebody hit your car, personal injury, property damages, contract, money. You want money. You want damages. That's civil. So where do you go if you just don't have
the People's Court?
And what is the People's Court called in Hot Springs, Arkansas?
Small claims.
Well, that's one of them. Excellent. Small claims. Small claims. We're not there yet. Small claims, you've got to have only $5,000, up to $5,000 damages. You can't have an attorney. If you walk into attorney with an attorney, they're going to bump you to the next court. So the very first thing you need to know about small claims is don't hire an attorney. That's the purpose, is for you to be able to get something resolved without hiring an attorney. Now, Lance Gardner used to be the small claims judge, but I'm not sure if he still is. I think it may be Bo Britton, but I'm not positive. But all you have to do, do you guys know where the court's building is? 607 Washita. It's the newer court's building. It's not the pretty one. It's the one across the way. You walk in there, you go down the hall, and you'll go where they have the court we're going to be talking about. I'm not going to tell you because one of you will know what it is. And you just say, I want to file a complaint for small claims. And they'll give you all the paperwork. It's very simple. You just fill it out and it's done. So before we get to the court that you would go to if you have DWIs or traffic, we probably need to talk a little bit about the county judge and what the county court does, which isn't very much. But if you have county property, and I've had three cases. I sat on the bench for like 22 years, and only three times did I have people appeal a county judge decision. But you can automatically appeal, but county judges can only hear cases by statute authority or by constitutional authority. They don't have any inherent authority like some of our other courts come down from, you know, the tradition of kings and queens. And that's how we hear cases, but not county judges. County judges deal with the quorum court, but they don't get to vote on whether or not an ordinance should pass by the quorum court. They only have veto power. But they do run, if you ever have gone to a quorum court meeting, justices of the peace are all elected by where they live. And each justice of the peace has a vote, but the county judge doesn't. But if you have, I had one case, two, I remember I affirmed what the county judge had done. One I reversed. And the one I reversed was a complicated case where you had a trust who wanted the county judge to say that the trust property on the lake solely could use the dock. Then you had some folks who just bought property on the lake, and part of the seller's guarantee was that the dock was theirs. So once the county judge said, no, it belongs to the trust, then the buyers sued, and they went to circuit court. And their first thing was to undo what the judge had done, and then we fought over who got to do what and how much damages really the buyers got back because they weren't able to buy the property they thought they were buying and it was misrepresented. So that was kind of a real interesting snafu that we got fixed, but they even appealed it and I got affirmed, but it was really difficult from the testimony to really figure out who should own the dock. So I can understand why it was difficult for the county judge to try to figure that out. He's also, or she, that's interesting too, you learn things when you do this. We've had one female county judge in Fayetteville. We've had one black county judge after Reconstruction in like Jefferson County. Most of our county judges thus far have been white males. Who knew? And their salaries, I thought their salaries were only $25,000 plus, because, you know, I was Googling and I was looking at the statute. But Mark Toss said, no, they've gotten a raise, and now the county judge makes about $86,000.
Book it out here.
Yeah, that's what he said. And I think Mark knows what he's talking about. He said that the justice of the peace makes $600 a month. And so, just like you, Dan Cameron's going, so what do they do? No. Well, he gets grants, federal, and he gets grants state, and if so, you know, he's kind of over that. He doesn't have any power over county executive officers, so he has no power over sheriffs, clerks, circuit clerks, treasurers, assessors, collectors, or coroners. And guess what the qualifications are to be a county judge?
You have to high school education.
It's worse than that, guys.
High school.
21 years of age.
Oh, well, high school. I said you have to be alive and breathing.
So let me tell you what's really interesting, especially if you were a juvenile judge. Not until 1989 did they fix it so bastardy, which are paternity cases, where you file for custody, child support, visitation, and juvenile cases where you deal with dependent neglected children in foster care, you deal with family in need of services, children who are either truant or runaways or disobedient at school or at home, or you deal with delinquents 17 and under who've committed a crime. Guess who got to hear all those cases until 1989?
County judge.
You serious?
With no legal training,
none.
Who?
The county judge.
Oh, county judge. Okay.
Amazing graces. We moved here in 1973, and I was just kind of, whoa, you know? But it got fixed. And we do have a famous county judge. Anybody know who Lonnie Warnicki is?
Baseball
player. Famous baseball player. They called him Hummingbird Warnicki. He was born in Mount Ida. He played for the Chicago Cubs in the 30s and the 40s. And he also played for the St. Louis Cardinals. And he was a county judge here from 1962 to 1973.
With training as a baseball player, made him a county judge.
Mm-hmm. Very popular.
Hard calls.
So in
1989, did they make the change?
Well, what happened is the General Assembly in 1988 passed a law changing, transferring those cases to state court judges. And so then, starting in 1999, they started hearing cases. And most of them were just called, I think the first one we had was Barbie Hargraves. And they weren't really a state court judge yet, but probably for about 2 or 3 years, they kind of were interims until we got actual judges, state court judges, for juvenile court. And most of the juvenile court judges were called chancery circuit judges. But let's go back to what court do you go to? That's county. Any more questions about county judge and county court?
And Davis is our county judge.
Yes.
But they can currently hear
constitutional cases?
No, very limited. All they can hear is county property disputes. And they can hear, when they do any type of annexation, if you don't like, if they've gotten you to pay taxes, you can go the equalization assessments. They will hear those with other justices of the peace or quorum court members. They also administer issues concerning our county roads and what gets paved and what doesn't get paved.
Court judge you're talking about. Mm-hmm.
But they don't hear very many cases at all.
Good.
Yeah.
What are their requirements?
21 years of age.
25.
Nope, 21.
21?
You can get called a judge.
21 years of age.
You guys,
age,
I'm so sorry.
And you're 6,000 a year.
I have 86 grand. I'm not making it up.
Okay, I actually did have a question. Is there no equivalent in Arkansas to what's known elsewhere as county court at law, which hears your juvenile cases, hears
juvenile
crime?
If you just hold your hat, we do. And the beautiful thing about us starting so late, you know, with, say, juvenile court, we're actually state of the art because we copied from everybody else. But our state courts are like what you're talking about. In other states, they call county courts.
Okay, and those are, that's the same thing basically as, say, family courts.
Yes,
some states
they're called
call them circuit
judges.
Courts, and they deal with divorces,
yes,
disputes,
and,
custody.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but right now, let's go back to you got a DWI, a traffic offense, or you have a little bit of property damage, or somebody bumped into your car, and up to $25,000 damages. Where do you go for civil, or if you've committed a misdemeanor where you could be jailed for 1 year in the county jail or have a $1,000 fine? What court hears all those cases? And there's a lot of cases.
District court, I mean, that's mm-hmm. what they call the real place.
It's district court. It used to be called municipal court, but now it's called district court. And we used to have, like, city court in Mountain Pine, but it has merged into our district courts. So I don't believe we have any other city courts that I know of. But district court has a huge docket, and we have two judges. And the goal is to finally have them full-time. But we're one of the few counties that still have them part-time. But by 2020, they'll have to decide, can one judge be full-time, or do we need to keep two judges for full-time? It'll be based on the docket, how they figure that out. But the pilot programs have gone all over the state, and now most district courts are full-time. And the qualifications are a little more strict. Anybody want to guess how old you have to be?
25.
Close. 26. And all these ages are interesting. Mm-hmm. They're so arbitrary.
But yeah. Still no education.
No, we're getting there.
Okay.
You have to have 3 years experience practicing law. Okay. And no jury trials take place in district court. And the vast majority of Arkansans who have any contact with the judiciary, it's through district courts. Mm-hmm. Small claims, we talked about that. What do you think the salary is for our, anybody know who our two judges are? I'm sure you do, our district court judges.
Ralph Ullman, it used to be Schweitzer.
And now it's Schweitzer's daughter, who's Meredith Schweitzer Rebsamen.
Well.
She was appointed by Governor Hutchinson. Whenever a judge dies or resigns or is impeached, which has never really happened, then the governor appoints a judge to sit in that place until the next general election. And they're also nonpartisan. So what do you think their salary is?
If he gets 86 for doing nothing, they should get a lot more.
Actually, theirs is 86, and it can be, by statute, not less than 65, not more than 86. So they get the maximum by statute. They work pretty hard, I'll have to say, really and truly. That's a rough docket.
Mm-hmm.
lots of people, because that's the same building where Division Two is for the circuit court. And I saw the traffic every day. It's pretty amazing how many people. And like, if you, how many of you been to district court? It's full, isn't it? I mean, it's just absolutely full. It's amazing.
So what's the most common cases that they're seeing?
Criminal, misdemeanor, criminal, DWI, traffic. And most traffic people just pay instead of fighting them. You know, so it's really mostly misdemeanor, criminal. They don't have a whole lot of civil, because mostly, unfortunately, people's damages are higher than their jurisdictional amount, $25,000.
They also do the adoptions, don't they?
Nope. A long time ago, when they had the juvenile and the bastardy, they may have. You know, and it wasn't all that long ago, so maybe they did.
You're saying bastardy?
That's paternity. That's
yeah,
what they call
I can't
it legally.
Believe they still call that. Okay.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah, it's pretty archaic.
It's very archaic. Yeah, but it's really paternity. But they, it's still called bastardy. Huh. Okay, now the court that probably you guys maybe are more familiar with is circuit courts. And before the General Assembly had Amendment 80, which passed in July of 2001, we had this division where you could be a chancery judge or you could be a circuit judge. Once they passed, or you could be both, circuit chancery. When I was appointed in 93, before this passed in 2001, I was a circuit chancery when I went to juvenile, but when I was appointed to take Judge Robbins' place, I was chancery only. So what's the difference? Anybody know between equity courts and civil courts? Equity courts are chancery courts, and civil courts are circuit courts. But now, of course, they're merged together by Amendment 80. But what did the equity courts do, or the chancery courts do?
Do they hear appeals from the lower courts?
Well, what they really heard mostly was dealing with people. Adoptions, guardianships, domestic relations. They didn't deal with civil cases, which were damages again. Remember, civil's damages for money. They didn't deal with jury trials, but they did deal with divorces, probate, estates, guardianships, adoptions, and they also dealt with the juvenile eventually, but not until we got the juvenile courts, and then they were both circuit chancery. But there's now five divisions by Amendment 80 for the divisions to hear, and domestic relations, probate, criminal, civil, and juvenile. And so each year we have how many circuit judges in Garland County?
Three.
Four. Each year, they decide for 2 years what the administrative plan will be. And they have an administrative judge. And when we did it, I retired 2014, December 31st. It was really just by who had been the judge the longest was the administrative judge. And they could do it for 2 years, 4 years, or whatever. I think I did it for four, but I'm not sure. But all you have to do is come up with the administrative plan, which is very simple. When I was there, the administrative plan was that Division 1 had 50% criminal and then had 25% of civil, probate, and domestic relations. Who is Division 1? Judge?
Wright.
John Homer Wright, yes. John Homer Wright. And he still hears 50% of all the criminal. I think his domestic relations has been reduced maybe to 20, but he has 25%. So he's going to be hearing jury trials, medical malpractice if they go to trial, and he's going to be hearing criminal if they have criminal trials. Welcome.
Hey.
See, she could tell you all about Justice of Peace. You want to share with them who you are? and what you do.
Hi. I'm Denise Marion. I'm Justice of the Peace in Garland County District 3.
Now tell us a little bit about what Justice of the Peace do, because we did county judges, and we've gone through what they can do and can't do. But what can you do?
How many of you were in the class last week? Maybe I don't need to do
maybe
this.
They don't
last
know.
Month.
Is there anyone who was not in the JP class last month? Okay. Well, there are 13 districts in the county. Each district has approximately 8,000 people in it. So there's a representative from each district that sits on a governing body, which is essentially the legislative unit of the county. You can think of it as the county legislature. So there are and we're called Justice of the Peace. So there's Justice of the Peace from each county. Yes, we can marry people. We can sign a marriage license. But we also consider policy, enact ordinances, and mainly we take care of the budget.
For the county.
For the county.
And how big is your budget? It's pretty big.
Pretty big. Millions of dollars.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, so welcome. We're talking about circuit courts, and we just talked about Division One, which has 50% criminal, and it has 25 probably civil, 25 probate, and then maybe 20 domestic relations. Division Two always has had a 100% juvenile. Right now, for a little while, Division Three is hearing all the dependent neglect cases. Those are kids that go into foster care until some things get resolved with the registry, and they hope that will happen fairly soon. But Division Two hears now 45% of domestic relations, and Division Three reduced from, I think he was hearing like 35, and now he's, you know, just hearing 20. So just to try to keep it even, Stephen. And then Division Two hears no adult criminal, and here's no, unless they need him to or she to hear it. And they don't have any civil, because when I was there, I worked on trying to get rid of the civil, because what would happen is we ended up with 4 in a 2-year time medical malpractice. These take about 3 weeks. And if you're a juvenile judge, if you have dependent and neglect cases, you have time constraints. You have to hear those cases from the time the petition's filed within 5 days. You have to have the adjudication within 30 days. And so you have to have a juvenile. If a juvenile's been arrested, you've got to hear that immediately within 24 hours. So you really have to have these jury trials, and you have to have all these kids come in and come out, and it's just, you know, difficult. And so that's why the Division II got rid of the civil, because of the length of the jury trials. Most cases settled. The jury trials have gone way, way down, mostly because the best practice is mediation. And now mediators are helping clean the dockets and also help the people be in charge. And most judges, they think it's the best practice, especially with domestic relations. It's just a really good device, and they're using it very well. But Division Two now is going full speed, and they're so happy. It's been really hard for them. Division Three, he hears no criminal. He does hear civil, 25%, or he or she, but Division Three right now is a he. And like I said, he's now hearing some of the dependent, all of the dependent neglect, and less of the domestic relations. And do you know who that, Judge Division Two, you guys know who that is?
Wade Nearmore.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Division Three?
Williams.
Lynn Williams?
Picture.
Yes, Lynn Williams. And then Division Four.
Marcia Hernsberg.
Yes, Marcia Hernsberg. And she again hears 50% like Division One. One and four hear all the criminal adult cases. So she hears 50% of those. Then she also hears 25 of domestic relations, civil, and probate. Any questions about our circuit judges and their divisions and what they hear?
Are they elected?
They're all elected. You know, they tried this legislative session to at least see about doing the Missouri plan, whereby the governor comes up with a cross-board of experts in the legal field, and they come up with names, and then he appoints them, and then each year the electorate decides if they should stay or not stay, but that didn't pass. They still feel very strongly, most of the people, the judges feel pretty strongly they want to be elected, and the Arkansas Bar felt pretty strongly that it should be merit because of all they called it the dark money. Over $40,000 was given to Supreme Court candidates by folks who they didn't know who they were. And so they were trying to eliminate some of that, but right now they're still elected.
All of them, the district court and the
all of them are elected, every single one. Now, on the circuit court, how many years do you think you have to have been born?
Same, maybe 26?
30.
No, did they change?
29.
It's just so funny because, you know, you never know. It's 28.
28.
How they get this?
How do you come up with a number like that?
Statutory, it's 28.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Level of expected maturity.
Yeah, right. 2 years more than the district court. Yeah.
Are they expecting people to age and then go up to the next thing?
That's kind of what happens. You'll see that with our qualifications.
Do you have to have more years' experience to be served?
Yes, you get to have 6 years' experience rather than the 3 of the district court.
Practicing law.
Practicing law, licensed attorney. And you also have to be of good moral character.
Not required for the other.
Previously
it's not mentioned until that. And then you need to be a U.S. citizen.
Oh.
Yeah.
But the others don't require that.
Well, they don't mention it. There's 75 counties in Arkansas, and we have 122 circuit judges. And our particular judiciary district is 18. Judiciary East, and we are very lucky because we only have one county. We have lots of judges who have 6 counties in the Jonesboro area or in the Delta area, and they have to travel from county to county. They have to take their court reporter and go to where the courthouses are. We don't have to do that. Pulaski doesn't have to do that. If you're a Malvern judge, they have both Hot Spring County and Grant, so they have Sherwood and Malvern. But that's a real luxury that Garland County circuit judges have.
Is that based on population of the counties?
Yes. Very interesting.
And what's that called? We're Division 18?
We're called 18th East, but it's called the, let's see, how's the best way to say it? 18th Judiciary East District.
Oh, okay.
For our circuit court.
Huh.
Pulaski County is the 6th. I know the Malvern, Hot Spring County is 30, but we basically have, I think, a really nice situation. For years, we also included Montgomery County, which is Mount Ida, but with this Amendment 80 that passed in 2001, they moved them to another district. Any questions about our state court judges?
The mediators. How do they select? They're not elected, are they?
No. What happens, and I'm certified to hear civil cases and domestic relation cases, probate cases. You have to go 3 times to hear juvenile, and it's been about 2 years, and I've had one I got to observe. I had one where the juvenile ran, so we didn't get to hear. It's a long process to get to hear juveniles, which is kind of sad, but I've heard a lot of domestic relations. And what you have to do is initially get 80 hours training, then you get certified. And to get certified to do civil cases, which would be what we've talked about, damages, jury trial cases, trying to settle them, you have to observe three different mediators. And, you know, they might want you to participate and they evaluate. And then domestic relations, the same thing. You have to observe three cases.
And you have to be an attorney.
No. Kay is a mediator. She gets to do juvenile, though, don't you? And I still don't. So how many have you done? I know, I guess it's okay because I've done a lot of domestic relations, but how many have you heard?
Not many. We've not had many being referred to juvenile the last
I have a question because I've never heard of mediation in juvenile cases. What is it like what type
some
of case?
Some were really more access visitation type things because they were
more like
people that the case may have started out as a family in need of service.
Yeah.
So it was in juvenile court, but it had to do with guardianship and where that kids lived. It could be students that got in a fight at school, you know, rather than charging them, they get charged.
Well, the best practice now is it's even better because they have a new risk assessment tool for juveniles. And the goal is to divert them out of the system because statistically, kids that we mess with and massage a whole bunch, probation officers love these kids that only commit shoplifting and get on probation because they do everything they're supposed to do.
And they still get the money.
No, and, I don't think they're looking at it that way.
Probation officers are
paid? They're going to be paid no matter how many kids they have.
Okay.
You kind of hit a raw spot there.
I'm just saying that they still have to pay to go to their probation officer.
They could earn money for the county if they had to pay probation fees. But I don't think that's really an issue. I think, you know, the issue is everybody is trying to keep kids that don't deem to be in the system out of the system. And the evidence shows that the ones we mess with and the ones we don't mess with, like the ones like me that never got caught, they turn out just the same. You know, but it's not good for them to have that for their self-esteem or just to be involved in the system if you can keep them out. So now the new risk assessment tool is kind of what Kay's talking about. It diverts them out of the system and it may get them involved in mediation. And mediation is very good to get the parents where they have an active role and they have ownership. Have the juvenile, for example, we used to order them a lot when we were trying to do restorative justice. When you have someone who's hurt somebody, or if they've stolen from somebody, and if they really get to hear what the victim survived because of their actions, then they get that genuine remorse, and the recidivism rate is like 5%. It's really low. So mediation is definitely the best practice. I really believe that. And what I really like, I'm part of this Access to Visitation, Custody, and Child Support. It's a federal grant, and you don't get paid very much. You don't get paid what private mediator gets paid. They usually charge about $150 an hour, and this program gives you $90, but it also makes the participants pay according to their income. So sometimes they pay $12 an hour or $25. But I really, really like it because yesterday we settled one, and they were very young, and they had a 3-year-old, and they had been trying joint custody. And they wanted to continue joint custody. Well, a lot of judges don't like joint custody, but if you do a mediation, then they'll sign off on it. And that's truly what they wanted to do. They wanted to have equal access. And so it worked very, very well. Now, I've only done probably about 20. I still take it kind of personally when they don't settle. You know, and mediators are not supposed to be attorneys. They don't give any kind of legal advice. They're just supposed to be facilitators of the process. They're not supposed to in any way tell the parties what to do or not to do. I like to have the attorneys present because then they can ask their attorneys for advice. But I really do like mediation a lot, and I think it's really helping our whole court system.
Vicki, I'm going to ask you, like, what are the qualifications of a mediator? How does one become a mediator?
80 hours training, right?
Where do you go for this training?
You go Little Rock. If you look up Google ADR, that's the Alternative Dispute Resolution. They have classes at least once a year. And then you take your classes, and then you just do the observation, and you get certified.
I know when we did complex litigation, sometimes we take out a part of it, take out these attorneys for this side and these attorneys for this side, and say, you guys go mediate how many staples you can put in a document. We're going to send you to the mediator for these
issues.
Yeah. And they have to mediate that to come back into court, you know, so that, you know, I recognize that and with, of course, divorces and some.
And if you want to take the long road there, UALR has a certificate program that is 6 graduate courses, so it's 18 hours.
You have to be a college graduate, though.
We do have arbitration,
to take a mediation,
but I do not know what the training is.
You do to go through the UAR graduate program for it.
So I
know that you would have to for that.
She was pretty famous. She did lots of arbitration. Do you know anything about arbitration? I don't know anything about arbitration.
I took the course. I have not done that. I did not go the private route. I went strictly the stuff through the legal.
I know that arbitration, you're bound by some of your contracts.
Some of them are binding, some of them are non-binding, but most usually they're binding.
So it's a little different kettle of fish.
But I've not practiced that at all.
So you could, what's really good about Kay is she was a special ed guru, and they have mediation for 504 or IDEA, which are two things that parents don't know. All they have to do is write, I want a mediation. And if they knew that, that would probably help them. It's
but
a
like
really
you
good tool.
In juvenile court, I've only done one special ed.
That's a resource that, man, I wish we could just shout it out to all the parents who have kids that are 504 or IDEA, because it's a really good resource. Okay, so you're not very happy with what that circuit choice judge ruled. He's making you pay all kinds of damages, and he's making you, you know, pay attorney fees. And you just really don't like that decision. Where do you go? What do you do?
Go to appellate court.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I haven't been passing these out, so I better start. This tells you everything you ever wanted to know about county courts.
Oh,
and there's stuff on the back. That one doesn't have it on the back. The next ones have them on the back.
It's two-sided.
Yeah.
Two-sided.
And,
this must be your original.
It is. And I don't think we have over 20, so we're fine. So, you're unhappy, and did you guys tell me where you go?
Court
of Appeals. And how many folks are on the Arkansas Court of Appeals? This
guess?
Is something I had to learn. Yeah, guess.
Two.
No.
Six.
20.
No.
Oh, you Six. Mean throughout all of Arkansas?
No. The Arkansas Court of Appeals, that's a body of judges that you go to appeal a circuit court decision. So they're
12.
Busy. 12, perfect.
Okay.
So, here they all are. We've got pictures of them on the front page. And then we've got pictures of each of them individually and what district they represent. Now, we're District 4 and we have 2, but our districts are really large. And this last page shows you the districts. And if you're really, really patient, you can see 1 through 7. But I can generally tell you, this is Pulaski County, which is 6. And then we're right over here, and we're pretty broad. Garland County has a lot of counties in our district, which is 4. Over here in Northeast is 1, And then this, I believe, in the middle is probably 2, Northwest is 3, 5 is down here, Calhoun and some of these Nevada, Ouachita counties, and then 7 is over here in the Delta. But anyway, our 2 judges, and you'll get these, Brandon Harrison, District 4, and David Glover. Now, David Glover, you may know, he's from Malvern, but Brandon Harrison, I think, is from one of these other, you know, it could be Sebastian County or some of these other counties that our District 4 is in. But they have 3 panels, and if you want the full Court of Appeals to hear your case, you could request it, but it's much faster if you just let it be assigned to a panel. And then if, you know, they don't agree, they're going to have to push it out with the whole group anyway. But we do have a Chief Justice of the Court of Appeals. Her name right now is Rita Gruber. And her salary is $164,000. And all the other Court of Appeals judges is $161,500. Now, once again, how many years do you think they have to be a licensed attorney? 8. We're moving on up, aren't we? They're nonpartisan. They have to be 30 years old.
I was going to say
good and moral character. And these same qualifications apply to the Arkansas Supreme Court judges. Same qualifications. And they deal mostly with folks that are unhappy with the circuit court. And they are very, very busy. They've grown. But here's the thing that I found out that I was just astounded. Okay, we became a state in what year? 1836, yeah. And so thereafter, they have constitutional, you know, what do they call them? Constitutional meetings, whatever. Yes, conventions. So they had one in 1874. And at that one, they said, we need to have Court of Appeals, okay? 104 years later, we finally have our first judges for the Court of Appeals. What a gap. Not until 1979, the governor finally appoints people to the Court of Appeals, and that is Bill Clinton, and he appointed 6 judges. Then in 1996, it went up to 9 judges, and in 1997, it went up to 12 judges, so it's grown.
Are they all appointed?
No, they're elected. Every one of them are elected, but initially when they first started, the governor appointed. Good question. That was something I sure didn't know.
Wow. Do the cases need to be heard by panels? I'm a little confused. Like, we don't just get, if we had a case there, we wouldn't just get heard by Harrison or Glover, or would we?
You might. See, I think there's 3 panels, and there's 12, so there's 4 people to a panel.
So they are heard by panels.
Yeah. And just yesterday, I was talking to Mike Crawford, and he said, but you can have the full panel, but it's going to take them a lot longer to hear your case. So most people just let the panels hear. And then if the panel can't agree, they're going to push it out to the whole group anyway. But it doesn't happen very often.
Do they actually hear arguments, or do they just read?
Mostly they read, but if you want to do oral arguments, you get to do oral arguments. And do you guys know where the Justice Building is in Little Rock?
Yeah.
Well, if you're at the Capitol, and you look over this way, it's on Marshall Street, and it's a beautiful building. And that's where the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeals are. It's a lovely building. Mostly glass.
Where does the panel come from?
They're elected. Court of Appeals, like, we elect the judges, and then they each are from a different district. Like, our District 4 has 2, and all the other Court of Appeals come from different, represent different.
So when you say panel, it's a panel of judges?
Yes.
I see.
I'm sorry. Yeah, and I presume it's 4-4-4, but I'm not positive. Anything else you want to ask about Court of Appeals? They're also busy.
So does, if I bring a case that came from Garland County, does that mean that the two Garland County?
No.
It can be heard by any of them?
Yes.
Okay.
In terms of an appellate judge being elected to that position, is that something, like, say one of our circuit judges had loftier goals to mm-hmm. be on the appeals, would they just throw their ring or say, I'm going
That's
to
That's exactly
run?
What happened. Judge Robbins, he ran for the Court of Appeals and was elected, and that was in 1992, and that's how I got appointed.
Oh, okay.
To take his place in January of 1993.
Also, what I meant to ask this for circuit, or actually all of the judges, what are the term limits? Are there term limits?
Yes, that's a very good
district
question.
District circuit and appeals.
Very good question. For district court, it's 4 years terms. For circuit, it's 6 year terms. And for Court of Appeals, let me see. I think it's 6 also.
I think it's 8, I believe.
Is it 8?
Yes.
And is it 8 also for the Supreme Court?
I don't know. It just says 8 at the bottom of the
okay.
chart.
Okay, so it must be 8. And then Arkansas Supreme Court, I bet, is the same.
Do we call the Court of Appeals judges or justices?
Judges, that's a good point. Some Supreme Court justices get upset in oral argument if you call them judges and not justices, but the Constitution actually does call them judges too. I learned that too.
So those are their terms. Are there limits?
No.
No, they can
so they can keep going.
Yes. And our Supreme Court, if you have writs of certiorari, mandamus, or habeas corpus, I had to look those up. Habeas corpus is when somebody's being detained or held in custody that they think shouldn't be. And so you go to the court and say, I think they need to get out, and you file a writ. That goes straight. Those are called extraordinary writs. They go straight to the Arkansas Supreme Court. The same with writ of mandamus. You're trying to get a public official to do something they're not doing. Or certiorari, that's a little more complicated. You don't like something that's going on a decision and you want them to interfere and fix it. Also, Amendment 28 of our Constitution in Arkansas gives the Supreme Court the right to regulate the practice of law for attorneys. They figure out what professional conduct should be, and they work with the Commission on Discipline and Disability for judges.
Is there an age limit
for
judges?
For Supreme Court?
For any of them. For
oh,
the justices.
70, and that's such a good question. Which they've tried to change that because, you know, the 70 now is a 60
no.
or 50.
Yeah, yeah. It came up, my brother's on the Texas Court of Criminal
mm-hmm.
Appeals.
Mm-hmm. What'd they do in Texas?
They held a special election to allow him to go one over because he was 2 years into a 6 year term. And so he got to finish his out. He, in effect, was in office until 75.
Wow. So that's kind of what they do in New York. We have a good friend who was a trial court judge, and they call him superior judges, I believe. But anyway, she was also 70. She had to take a psychological test, and she had to pass it. But then they let her go beyond. But Arkansas, you can't run once you're, you know, 70. And so Judge Robbins would have stayed on the Court of Appeals, and if any of you know him, he's brilliant, sharp as a tack, and it was just silly that we didn't get to keep him because he turned 70. Judge Hewitt also was a very good juvenile judge in Sebastian County. He was age limited, And again, I hope they change that, but they tried to change it in the General Assembly, I believe, the last term, and they wouldn't change it. They can't.
And the Supreme Court, you can be absolutely a doddering fool.
Yes, because Supreme Court, you're there for life. All the federal judges, they have to go through a process where the president gets from the Senate or he gets from the House of Representatives names of folks, and then the Senate has to confirm, but then they get to be appointed to their judgeship from federal court, district courts, to our Court of Appeals, to our U.S. Supreme Court, and all those folks are there for life. So it's very different. They're not so, elected.
So the person who's now occupying 1600 Avenue cannot remove everybody. Is that the case?
Yes.
Only the attorneys, not the judges.
Can you believe that? The Thayer, his wife is lovely. She's a juvenile judge in, you know, the Jonesboro area, which, like I said, is six or seven counties. Her husband, he's responsible for getting convictions for all those Delta drug guys. He was an excellent district attorney. They didn't even tell him he was out. He found out when he saw the news release. Did you read that in the Gazette?
Gosh.
Yeah.
Well, do you remember when Bush did it?
Same thing?
No, not even when you left. But those people, one, the fellow here was a Republican, and he, I heard that they did a panel at the center, and he quit because of how unfair it was. And he was one of the most marvelous people I've ever
seen. Yeah, I do remember him.
He was wonderful.
Yeah, he was very compelling.
I don't know if everyone knows, but can you just give a brief recap of exactly what happened in that situation with the firings and of all the district
okay,
attorneys?
Jeff Sessions decided that he wanted to clean house, and he got rid of all the federal attorneys throughout the United States. Just got, no matter what their qualifications, how good they were, if they were Democrats, Republicans, they got zapped.
I was going to get rid of the Republicans,
well,
sure. Too.
I don't know.
I thought it was 46 Democrats. Is what I
thought. I think it's mostly Democrats.
Yeah, well, sure, but were there some Republicans?
I don't know. That's a good question.
You need to ask that.
That's a very good question.
What did you, I can't.
She wanted to know if any Republicans got zapped.
Oh, well, we do know that Trump's sister resigned about 3 weeks before. She was a federal appeals court judge, believe it or not, and she resigned in time just very recently before one of those scandals there's been coming.
I'm going to move along real fast because I think we're supposed to almost be through.
Oh, yeah, we are.
The Arkansas Supreme Court has seven judges. This will tell you everything you ever wanted to know. They started out with three, then they went up to five. Three in 1874, five in 1899, and then 1924, seven, and they're still at seven. They hear extraordinary writs. Their qualifications are the same as the Arkansas Court of Appeals. 8 years licensed attorney, 30 years of age, good moral character. Their salaries, the Chief Justice, which is Dan Kemp, newly elected, is 180, and the deputies is 166.5. And then the federal courts we have. Our federal court is the Eastern District. It's where the post office, you know, used to be. It's the old federal building. They want us to get rid of it and have to go to Sebastian County, but so far we've been able to keep them from doing that. But the federal court judge that hears cases is Judge Miller. And then we also belong to a pretty huge District 8 with, if you appeal something from the federal court, and usually the federal decisions are one state residents against another, it's diversity of citizenship, they have to have at least 75,000, I think, damages, and it has to be a federal question, could be about constitution laws or treaties, but mostly they're citizens of two different states. They also do felonies where you commit a felony in more than one state. Those go to federal courts. Our federal court cases, 80% are civil that they hear, 20% are criminal. And this shows you the districts. We're in District 8, which is pretty interesting because we're with Missouri, and then the rest of the states are like Minnesota. It's very different. The U.S. Court of Appeals, I think, is probably fairly busy because they hear, just like our Court of Appeals, anything that comes from the lower federal court. Whereas the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court, kind of gets to pick and choose what they want to hear and what they don't want to hear. And here's, again, our seven different... Elena Kagan's on the back. But this tells you a little bit about our U.S. Supreme Court judges' backgrounds, where they came from. Most of them, a lot of them, came from the Court of Appeals circuit. A lot of them came from the D.C. circuit. And that's where Roberts came, and I think that's where, is that where Ginsburg came from? I think it is.
Well, she lived
because
she would have been here in New York.
Yes, yeah. And the chief of the U.S. Supreme Court, of course, we know is Chief Roberts, and his salary is $223,500, and all the others is $213,900. They are first picked by the president, and then they have to be confirmed by the Senate. And we're in that process right now.
Could you repeat their salaries?
Yes. $223,500 is the chief, which, you know, is Judge Roberts. And then the other Supreme Court justices, it's $213,900. And they're for life tenure, unless they retire, resign, or impeached, and none have ever been impeached. And one of the most important cases that you learn about in law school, which is important right now, is Marbury versus Madison, which gives the Supreme Court the right to do judicial review. So if folks mess up, they can fix it. And Madison had messed up. So just throwing that out. But any questions about our U.S. Court of Appeals or our U.S. federal courts or our U.S. Supreme Court?
No, but I have a question locally. Considering these salaries, how do we justify the salaries we pay locally? Is it over $120,000, $150,000?
What is it now? $160,000 for circuit judges.
No, for our local attorney.
Oh, attorney.
Local city
wow,
attorney.
Wow, that's a really good question. How much does B. Albright make?
It's over $120,000. It was $120,000 when they upped it. Now, for something as local as our little city, you can make, these people have to do major cases, and they're not making twice what
you. But you know, they don't hear hardly any cases.
Oh, of course not.
It's filtered out by that time, by the time it gets to them.
I don't know. I would think having to deal with some of the stuff he has to deal with, it might be.
Yes,
really
interesting.
Yes. Does anybody want any of these extra handouts? Do you have friends or anyone you want to give them to? Just go for it, because I don't want them. I think, you know, a regular attorney who does a really good job probably can make $200,000 plus or whatever. And so, kind of to answer your question, they get good retirement and they get good insurance, which a private attorney wouldn't have.
Yes.
So it's kind of a balancing thing there. But I've watched some of those city council meetings. And,
they could be
brutal.
No, the city attorney. She was concerned about the city attorney.
Brian Albright.
Does anybody want any of these?
I'm looking to see.
Did
you
want one?
Yeah.
Circuit court.
I
didn't do handouts for circuit, but I'll tell you, if you just Google, there's something called Ballopia or something. It has really... You know, do. Anybody else want any more? Okay.
I have a question.
Yes.
What is a good source to find out, or to use to find out if the judge is doing a good job when it comes time to vote.
Yeah, that's a real good question, because we don't have, some states actually have, you know, the type of cases and how often they were affirmed or how often they were reversed, but I don't think we have that data.
So it should be on, it should be a merit election type thing that you were talking about.
That's what the Missouri plan is, and we don't have that. They're just nonpartisan, generally elected.
Well, what about the Arkansas Bar Association?
The bar doesn't actually have grade cards for judges. Yeah, it's just a political hot potato. And it probably would be very useful to consumers to have that information.
And none of them declare whether they are Republican-leaning or Democratic.
With the Amendment 80, they used to. You used to be partisan. But after 2001 and then starting in January of 2002, you were nonpartisan.
Which is horse pooky.
Oh, yeah, because they all know I'm a liberal Democrat, you know. But now it's probably better that they don't have to say, because, you know.
It's bad enough as it is.
It's rough and tough.
Well, explain that. Why is it better? Because I'd like to know that.
Well, because Democrat now is kind of a bad word.
She wouldn't even stand a chance to get
a law.
And a judge, it should be nonpartisan.
It should be nonpartisan.
Well, yeah, but I mean.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying.
Right.
It should be that. Okay. They're not going to rule one way or the other because of their political beliefs.
If you're acting in a particular really political party and you judicial your candidates. Judge yeah. running in a different party, would you feel like you were necessarily going to get a fair shake?
And that's a very good perception.
And
they're supposed to be fair and impartial.
Mm-hmm. How about, so the only place where mediation really works is at that, I lost it. Before the appellate district, is that right?
No, it works everywhere, but where they're using a lot is circuit courts, but they can use them with Court of Appeals, they can use them with any of the courts we've discussed, they can order mediation. And it's considered the best practice.
I have a friend who does that in Boulder, and she says it's really unclogged their courts.
Oh, yes.
Unbelievable.
Yes. It's just wonderful. Like, what we did yesterday, we took these poor young kids and kept them from maybe ever having to go back to court.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is wonderful. It's fabulous. So you really feel like you've done something worthwhile. And they own that agreement. They figured it out. It's theirs. It's about their three-year-old. You know?
Yeah.
And it addresses all the behind-the-scenes things that wouldn't necessarily
come out in court.
Said in court in front of the judge that is the real problem and strife to begin with. So, yeah, they're happier in the long run with the agreement.
Katie, would this be beneficial to take to the Democratic headquarters we have?
Oh, sure.
Go. Thank you.
Well, we have people on here.
Yeah, sure.
That's a good idea.
Very good.
Of course.
Anything else? Is there anything muddy that needs to be cleared up?
So can I just ask it? This is a dumb question, but there are essentially
dumb questions.
Five layers of courts before you even get out of the state. Is that right? And then,
well, there's the district court.
Okay, and the first is that really.
Well, the county's so little that
okay,
it doesn't
really count. That all right.
District court does count.
Okay.
And from district court, you can go to circuit.
Okay.
From circuit, you can go to Court of Appeals.
Yes.
And from Court of Appeals, you can go to the Supreme Court.
Oh, okay.
That's it. But then the federal's a whole different kettle of fish. Because
that was all in Arkansas.
That's just Arkansas. With federal, you start with federal court. And then from there, if you don't like it, you go to the U.S. Court of Appeals, which is all these different districts. We happen to be in District 8. And then from there, it's really pretty limited what the Supreme Court hears, U.S. Supreme Court.
They'll put it back. They'll bounce it back to the court.
And then guess who our judge is? Every Supreme Court judge has a district. And guess who ours is?
Don't tell me it's a poem.
It's Alito.
Oh.
And Hollis, if anything happens on national park property, it automatically goes to federal court.
Because it's national park.
I didn't realize that.
And this is why you see people pick certain courts, like District 9, San Francisco, very liberal. So when they did the thing against...
The Hawaii?
Oh, yeah.
That's why it was there. Anybody that works for an oil company, it's always District 5, because that's...
It's very conservative.
So you get to know your courts, and 3 is D.C., mm-hmm. so you get to know which courts are liberal courts and which courts are conservative.
And do people have a choice then? Do attorneys have a choice of saying, well, we want to be in this district to do that?
When I worked for the oil company, we always filed in 5.
Right.
Always.
Which may not be your area where you live or anything.
Well, not sure where you're going to get the hearing you want to hear.
Yeah.
So, they say there's only 2 ways to impeach somebody, and I know this has nothing to do with our civics class, but one is a constitutional convention. So how do we make a constitutional convention?
We don't necessarily want one of those, because that can backfire.
We don't want one because they say Congress won't do it.
If you have a constitutional convention, you open that up to anything in your constitution. You're not limiting it.
There's scuttlebutt of having one now, and it may not go the way we would like.
There's a lot of really good things in our Constitution that I would hate for us to mess with.
Yes. Yeah. I'm glad I asked that question, because I had no idea.
I heard an argument that using the 26th Amendment. The convention approach to the Electoral College, trying to get the Electoral College thrown out, is really not the best way to approach that. And while a lot of states, including California, are getting around that, is they're passing laws that say that their electors have to vote the way the popular vote was, because they don't want to have big constitution. Because of
constitutional
reason,
California, they changed it. We can't gerrymander like they do in most other places, and so it doesn't matter. It's the weirdest thing. It works out great, but it's very strange. You can have only Democrats running because of the way they've got it set up. You may be in a place where there's not a Republican going to run. It's one Democrat against another Democrat. That's what they had this year down in the LA area. So your choice was a Democrat or a Democrat. It's not because of the way they reapportioned and changed it.
Can you hear?
So.
Yeah.
Depends
Thank
on
you very
state.
Much.
Well, you're very welcome. I'm very frustrated because just recently Alito said the U.S. Supreme Court wouldn't hear something that was one of our issues. Mm-hmm. I can't remember what it is. It just happened like...
LGBT, they won't... That was it.
Thank you. Because I've been
bathrooms.
Sitting here thinking, what was it?
They won't hear about bathrooms?
Somebody help me with that.
They refused to do that.
Transgender
they refused
boy
to hear that LGBT.
So what does that mean?
Somebody help me
with
that.
Threw it back to the lower court.
Wouldn't
lower
that
court
all be solved
prevails.
Just if we lived like in Europe where there is no gender? It's just a bathroom.
That's what
right.
we have in the courts building for, you know, Circuit Division 2
Wouldn't
is.
That just take
wow. They're
wow.
all unisex wow. bathrooms.
Well, I listen to Right Wing Radio, and their big deal is it's not the bathrooms, it's the showers in the schools. They don't want transgender people. They don't want some
just,
guy dressed up like a girl in the showers with their kids, and that's all their big
then
deal.
Then they should put up shower curtains.
Yes. Well, the schools that have been dealing with that for years and years, like in LA County, there's a school that's been dealing with this for like 15 years,
mm-hmm.
and they have not had one single issue.
Right.
So the whole thing is just total smoke.
It's a
smoke.
Well,
exactly.
It's like when they talk about voter fraud,
it
doesn't
exist.
It's
a way to bully
somebody.
If we're involved in discussing that particular issue, there are other issues really more important in this country that we're not being.
Absolutely. And how many people are even in that category? Very small number.
Well, that's
and
a diversionary tactic.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know that the
Thank
guns
you
in the, in the schools and the courts that passed the House and the